Rivalries are the lifeblood of hockey.
Hockey's best played not as mayhem, but on the verge of mayhem.
Oh, we got problems right now.
Playing in that building is a tough place to play, and they certainly don't like some of our guys very much.
Rivalry, in my opinion, pure and simple, is hatred.
Where one moment freezes in time. And intensity rises to the occasion.
I don't like them.
I don't like any guy on your team.
I'm not saying I apologize for it, because I don't.
Whatever you do, don't lose to Philly.
And the Battle of Pennsylvania is about to begin.
I'm Ed Conway, broadcaster for the Pittsburgh Penguins. One of the new teams in the National Hockey League this year.
For the Philadelphia Flyers, one of the six new expansion teams that will be taking part in the National Hockey League.
As part of the first expansion in 1967, Philadelphia and Pittsburgh were awarded NHL franchises. And on October 19, 1967, the two teams met for the first time at the Spectrum in Philadelphia. The Flyers took the game 1-0. From that day, however, the rivalry didn't unfold quite as expected.
The rivalry really wasn't born, didn't really have a great chance to be, because the Penguins were pretty bad for most of those years.
It was some tough times. It was some good players that came through here, but we just had trouble winning games.
While the floundering Penguins were searching for an identity, Bobby Clark and the Broad Street Bullies were running roughshod over the NHL.
To Clark, shot, oh, rebound, score!
With back-to-back Stanley Cup championships in 1974 and 1975.
Well, the Philadelphia Flyers in the late 70s were both the most hated and the most loved franchise. The way they played gave them a swagger, and they go into a building and was like, hide the women and children, the Flyers are coming in town.
Broad Street Bullies really set the measure of what the Philadelphia Flyers were. They were a hard-nosed, tough team that competed hard every night. They expected to win.
That's the thing, they didn't want to just beat you on the scoreboard, they wanted to beat you up.
The Spectrum resided on South Broad Street, an arena with an atmosphere as intimidating as the style of play the Flyers became so famous for.
The Spectrum was a house of horrors for visiting teams, because the Flyers were the biggest, baddest team out there.
And that reputation built year after year after year. And after a while, players didn't want to come in there. Unless you were a tough guy, you didn't want to walk into that building.
The atmosphere inside was carnivorous, and that's not a bad thing. I mean, it helped contribute to what the Flyers were doing. The fans fed off the players and vice versa there.
Venues play a huge part of the rivalry. I mean, nobody wants to play in Philly. I mean, back in the day with the Spectrum, I mean, the fans are right on top of you, and they're in your face. I mean, they're yelling at you, they're screaming at you. They're intense, they're tough.
And a lot of players were just very nervous walking into that barn.
The rough and tumble atmosphere of the Spectrum proved hostile for all opposing teams, but victories were most elusive to their Western Pennsylvania rival.
I remember with the Penguins, it was automatic. You're just not going to win there.
Well, the Battle of Pennsylvania was mostly one-sided. I mean, people remember 15 years and 42 games had just taken it from them in the Spectrum.
The Flyers' dominance reigned supreme over the Penguins. 42 games lost, 15 years winless at the Spectrum. From 1974 to 1989, a record of 0-39-3.
It didn't matter. We could be up 2 or 3 goals with 5 minutes to go. They'd find a way to win.
What's going to happen tonight? How are they going to lose this game, or at least get out of here without a victory? And sure enough, time after time, they'd come in. You almost get the point where you felt sorry.
Man, they just loved rubbing our nose in it. But you know what? That's what built the rivalry. That's what built what it is today.
After 15 years as a doormat, the Penguins instantly reversed their fortunes with the first pick in the 1984 draft.
You could just feel the momentum kind of change for the franchise and what he meant to it.
It gave us hope. It gave us hope as players. It gave the fans hope that maybe someday we'll have a winning season. We didn't talk about winning Stanley Cups. We just wanted to be respected throughout the league, and Mario gave us that respect.
As After years as cellar dwellers, the Penguins' fortunes were about to change. In 1984, Pittsburgh drafted an 18-year-old phenom, Mario Lemieux.
La première choix, number 66.
Lemieux was a savior, giving the Penguins, bankrupt less than 10 years earlier, the star power and talent they needed to turn their record and the rivalry around.
It wasn't really until the 80s when they had the opportunity to draft Mario Lemieux that kind of changed the fortunes and the fate around for the Pittsburgh Penguins and gave them that NHL credibility and the ability to compete with other teams on a much higher level.
Behind it comes Lemieux. Hook it in!
There wasn't a real tight rivalry until they got Mario.
After 15 years of suffering from the Philly flu, the Penguins entered their personal house of horror on February 2nd, 1989. Led by Lemieux, they finally skated away with a win.
Yeah, I think when we finally beat them in 89 in their building and broke that streak, it was unbelievable what that one victory did to us moving forward as a team that year, in the early 90s winning cups. But I think from now on, that when Penguin teams roll into Philadelphia, they believe they can win every time they go in there. So it was important to go through that because it's everlasting, the hatred that we have for Philadelphia Flyers. It makes it now that people don't forget how bad it was at one time. So every time we win there, people relish in it a little bit more.
The Penguins' confidence grew, and with it, so did the rivalry. Later that year, on April 25th at the Igloo, the Battle of Pennsylvania escalated into a war.
The Penguins just dominated Philadelphia in the early part of that game. Mario was just absolutely on fire. Everything he touched was going in.
Now a chance for Lemieux.
Ronnie Hextall just got to the point where he got bothered. He got bothered by the goals being scored. And he took exception to it.
Well, it's funny. My vision of Rob Brown's reaction after he scored was a little different than it actually was. I thought he was kind of wheeling his arm around, and they were beating us pretty bad. This decided my frustration boiled over, and I was going to go after him. But thank God I didn't catch him.
The Penguins certainly had the right chemistry with Lemieux, winning back-to-back Stanley Cup championships in 1991 and 1992.
The Flyers had been a beaten-down franchise in the early 90s at a time when the Penguins were winning two cups. Philadelphia needed something.
Now it was Philadelphia's turn to struggle. The Flyers needed their own star, a match for Lemieux. Through a complicated trade with Quebec, they found a prodigy, Eric Lindros.
Now there is somebody Flyers can hang their hat on, build a team around that can challenge really the offensive greatness of what Pittsburgh had.
Lindros, you know, came in with great expectations and for the most part backed them up.
5 years later, these superstars met in the 1997 Eastern Conference quarterfinals, the rivalry heightened by a playoff setting. The Flyers won the series 4-1. But what most remember was the standing ovation that Mario Lemieux received from the Philly faithful that night.
The last game that Mario Lemieux played in Philadelphia, the fans recognized it. And for a city that hated its rivals, the fans stood up and gave him a standing ovation. And I don't think he ever forgot that.
Yeah, that was very respectful. I mean, to show their appreciation for a guy that they'd booed for years was kind of going off into the sunset was awesome. I mean, those are pretty neat moments in sports for all athletes, and Mario deserved it.
There aren't many people who warrant that sort of accolade. He kind of emerged beyond the rivalry into just an appreciation for the sport.
The Flyers and Penguins, now formidable rivals, were willing to hammer each other all night. And in an epic fourth game of the 2000 Eastern Conference semifinals, they seem prepared to do it all morning as well.
So the Flyers go into Pittsburgh. They need to win the game to take control of the series. It's anybody's series at that time.
It went on and on and on. 12 o'clock, 1 o'clock, 2 o'clock.
You know, after a while, you're like, wow, what period are we in? I mean, you just kind of lose track of time.
Can't believe what I'm seeing here tonight, how they have battled.
Guys were actually going through in between periods, eating pizza, eating bananas, trying to get protein shakes. They were running out of food for the players to keep them able to play.
For only the third time in NHL
overtime.
It was a little chip play that went up the wall to Keith Primeau, and somehow he made an outstanding move around Darius Kasparaitis and fired a wrist shot high to the top of the net past Rantanen. That played tremendous in the game.
Primeau off the bench, is onside. Primeau moves deep and stops the shot. He scores!
The great thing about that game to me was the fact that Keith Primeau, he didn't cheat anybody. He got a great shot off to win that hockey game, and that was awesome.
It was classic. It was a classic end. And once the Flyers won that game, you knew they were winning that series.
In 2005, the strapped Penguins needed another franchise saver.
Occasionally, a generational player comes along where you just know he is going to be a star.
And with the luck of a sweepstakes, they found one. A new generation would take the simmering rivalry and heat it to a rolling boil.
Those rivalries with the Flyers and Penguins started then, and they really picked up steam when Sidney Crosby got into the mix.
Much like Mario Lemieux had once changed the face of Pittsburgh hockey, Sidney Crosby did the same for the Penguins franchise when he was drafted in 2005.
The Penguins would not be in Pittsburgh if they had not taken Sidney Crosby. This was a franchise that was on death's door. Like Lemieux decades before, he essentially saved the franchise. Everyone understood that Crosby had the potential not only to be a game changer, but a league changer.
Sidney Crosby, I remember in Philadelphia, he went up against Darrian Hatcher, and he wanted to put Sidney Crosby in his place.
Darrian Hatcher performs Sherwood root canal on Crosby. No penalty. Crosby goes ballistic, starts complaining.
You know, bleeding like crazy, whining to the officials, no call. The fans in Philly were going nuts. They wanted Sidney Crosby's head.
This is where the Sidney Crybaby nickname comes from. At the end of the game, Crosby gets the last laugh.
We were down two, we tied it in the third, and then I remember scoring the overtime winner. And from then on, I think I've always heard boos there.
And the rivalry assumed a new shape. Sidney Crosby versus all of Philadelphia. There was no love lost when it came to Sid.
Well, there's no secret. He has a little chip on his shoulder, and I think other people are aware of that. And he comes to play, and he comes, and he's feisty, and he's rubbing people the wrong way.
I don't like him.
Why don't you like him?
Because I don't like him. I don't like any guy on their team.
Well, Mr. Crosby definitely won't be the mayor of Philadelphia anytime soon.
He takes more verbal abuse than any player that I can remember coming into Philly. And he backs it up with great play, which only makes them yell louder. I think he feeds off it. And if you're playing for the Flyers and you make, you know, good contact with Sidney Crosby, you're definitely going to be getting a lot of pats on the back walking around town. It's that type of rivalry that's what, to me, makes Crosby such a great attraction.
What Sidney Crosby has done for this rivalry is beyond anything in sports. It was big enough to begin with, but he brought it to a boiling point level, an absolute boiling point. I don't even think Flyers fans know who's in goal for the Penguins when Crosby's on the ice. Nobody else exists. I swear, if you put on the screen just Crosby vision, right on the screen in the middle of the ice, all eyes would be on the middle of the ice looking to see, is he crying now? Who's he complaining to now? Look at that little whining little girl.
Crosby's first playoff encounter with Philly only heightened the tensions.
These teams have really developed a genuine hate for each other.
When you get into the playoffs, that's when real rivalry occurs. And we had a couple good ones with the Flyers, which evolved to something more.
Lemieux out front, scores! Off it! The Penguins will be in the Stanley Cup final for the first time since 1992.
The Penguins dominated the series, their first ever playoff series win against the Flyers.
I think that series, you know, two physical teams, obviously you don't get that far in the playoffs without playing a certain way, but it did start a bit more of a rivalry there.
The two rivals also met in the playoffs the following year in the 2009 Eastern Conference quarterfinals.
Aaron Shot scores! Billy Garrett! The Penguins win 3-2. They lead the
The Flyers took two of the next three games to set up a pivotal Game 6, a game which the Flyers led 3-0 in the second period. But then, Pittsburgh's Max Talbot engaged Daniel Carcillo in a fight that Talbot had little chance to win, but not much to lose.
I understand why Max Talbot is fighting here, but if you're Dan Carcillo, there's really no reason.
We always joke with Talbot, he didn't really put on a dominant performance in the fight. But for some reason, we got a lot of jump out of that. And he just, for whatever reason, he turned the momentum. And I mean, to score three in a row right after that fight, it gave us a huge boost. And you look at turning points in playoff series and even, you know, the whole playoff itself, that's right there.
The Penguins scored five unanswered goals to win Game 6, clinch the series on Philly ice, and continue their title quest.
The horn sounds and the Penguins have won the Stanley Cup!
Watching Sidney Crosby and the Penguins lift the Stanley Cup further fueled the animosity in Philadelphia. 3 years later, the rivalry would be ratcheted up to an even higher level.
Oh, okay. We got problems right now. Tony Granato right here going at it. We're glad you left.
I'm not saying I apologize for it because I don't. I was frustrated at the time. And just one of those moments where you kind of snap and you lose it. You don't remember exactly what you did.
It wasn't a playoff game yet, but it felt like one.
Talk about rivalries. And you know, the situation was we knew we were going to play them a week or so later. And every battle that was going on in that game was going to be a carryover in the playoffs.
10 days before the postseason began, the Flyers and the Penguins faced off with playoff-like passion.
I think it was Vitaly on their team. You know, he stepped up and he laid a solid hit on Danny. You know, it was just reactionary from there. We ended up having a line brawl. That definitely set the tone for the playoff series.
Okay. Oh, we got problems right now. Tony Granato right here going at it. We're glad you left.
You know, he's very emotional, and obviously he let his emotions go.
It's just one of those moments where you kind of snap and you lose it. You don't remember exactly what you did.
Granato left furious at Ballspa.
I'm not saying I apologize for it, because I don't. I was frustrated at the time, and that's, I guess, my point. It brings out the worst sometimes in you.
That's part of it all. That's part of the rivalry. I mean, that stuff happens. And like I said, there's a hatred there between the two teams. There's no doubt about it.
I've seen coaches go at it like that. And I really thought, you know, this one might end up like the old days of the Spectrum when they had to have an iron gate in between to keep the players away from each other. It's impossible to bottle the emotions and have it just in the players.
That animosity continued in the 2012 Eastern Conference quarterfinals. Pittsburgh and Philadelphia were at each other's throats, much like the days of old.
The Philly-Pittsburgh series of 2012 was hot tub time machine hockey. We were suddenly back in the 1980s. It was just wild. There were lots of goals.
You know, there were some great hockey plays. There was fights. There was, you know, everything I think you can imagine that you'd want in a series. The passion in everyone's eyes. You want to kill them, you know, just as much as they want to kill you.
That was the most intense hockey I played in my life.
It was bedlam. That's entertaining hockey. I mean, that is hockey at its oldest, purest form.
Having lost the first two games of the series, Game 3 in Philadelphia seemed pivotal. The Penguins decided it was time to send a message.
We had a bad start. We were flat, and I think they had a couple goal lead, and I just thought that we needed something to kind of, you know, stir something up a little bit, maybe to change momentum.
And Sidney Crosby, who is so incredibly intense, lost a little bit. Jacob Voracek's glove is lying on the ice. He swats it away. Well, that starts something, and there are fights breaking out. You know, it's just a mess. And it's the kind of things that Sidney Crosby should just be avoiding, but he doesn't.
I think looking back, that's probably, I would have been better off going out there and scoring a goal instead of starting something like that. But it's part of the emotion. Sometimes that stuff happens.
Pittsburgh lost 8-4, but rebounded to win the next two.
Far side, the shot, score! The Penguins are going to win Game 5.
In a memorable opening shift of Game 6, the Flyers and Claude Giroux took control and took down the Penguins star.
Philadelphia had lost a couple games. It looked like it was going to be a very short series. The Flyers need something. And on the first shift, Giroux tells Briere, watch out. Sure enough, puck comes back to Crosby off the opening draw.
Boom. That's the way to start the game. Close your room up against Sidney Crosby, and you want to get the fans going in your own building.
G started the game, and he said, watch the shift. And he called it before, and he went on giving a big body check to Sidney Crosby, and then scoring a goal on his first shot.
It was a statement shift like we've maybe never seen.
I just wanted to have a good start, and just wanted to go after the puck. And I mean, he didn't expect me to come in to hit him. And obviously, that quick goal kind of helped us get in the game and got the fans on their side right away.
I could pick one shift, you know, on the top of my head, that was, you know, probably the biggest game-changing moment was definitely that face-off. 5 seconds in, lays out Crosby, goes down 20 seconds later and snipes a goal posting in. It was, if you could be in that arena.
Picked up here, though, by Giroux. Shot, score! Giroux, just 32 seconds in.
Just how excited, you know, Claude was when he scored, and gives the old fist pump, let's go. And it was just great to be a part of it, great to be on the ice for it.
Probably the most memorable shift that I in recent times that I can remember. Impactful, without question. Flyers went on to win the game and move on to the next round.
Congratulate the Flyers and their organization on the series win. And I really can't wish them good luck, though. But
it was a wild series. Goals, checks, fights, old-time hockey flourishing in the 21st century.
It was pretty amazing to see just that intense hatred for each other, the kind of thing that makes fans just want to watch. Whether you're a Flyers or a Penguins fan, you want to tune in for that type of game. It took it to another level.
Because it was the Penguins, the Stanley Cup might as well have been in the house. The fans were ready to win the Stanley Cup on the basis of, we beat the Penguins, we beat Crosby's team, we are the champion.
The series was a vivid reminder that there are few rivalries as riveting as the Battle of Pennsylvania.
And that rivalry goes back a long, long ways. It's beautiful, and it is something that I think everybody looks forward to.
A shot! It's good! Kate Primo!
Every game against them, you gotta be prepared to go to war.
Got problems right now.
It's one of the best games in town and the best shows in town.
Yeah, just another kind of wild scene.